So let me start from thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk about my work in this wonderful meeting. So I'll be talking about work reported over here with my collaborator Sumanth and Professor Padmanabh. So I will try to argue about what kind of roles quantum correlations can play, in especially in curved space-time settings. And I will basically talk about one cute demonstration of this effect, where even inertial observers see a radiation which is very analogous to Unruh radiation. So let me start with Unruh radiation. So this diagram, by now you must have been familiar with, is called the Penrose diagram. This is a Penrose diagram of a flat space-time. So the 45 degree lines here depict the null rays. So all null rays starting from asymptotic past start from these two surfaces. This moves towards rightwards, and this moves leftwards. So any left to right moving null ray will start from here and end here. Similarly, any right to left moving null ray will start from here and end here. And this is the Minkowski space. I plus and I minus are time like past infinity and time like future infinity. So any time like observer will start from here and end over here. But Unruh effect is the effect of a effect for a eternally accelerating observer, which is depicted by this green curve. And this observer starts from the scry minus and ends up at scry plus because he has to move at the speed of light at t is equal to minus infinity and plus infinity. So from this diagram, we can see that he will be receiving signals from some patch of space-time, but not will be receiving signal from this patch of the space-time. So for his description of space-time or any matter field he observes, he will not be affected by anything happening over here. He has to trace over the description of the space-time or matter field if you are willing to, he is concentrating upon. And hence the density matrix, if he calculates, it will turn out to be for ground state in flat space-time to be that of a thermal density matrix and will associate some temperature. And this is the radiation which he observes and witnesses the Unruh radiation. For appearance of such a radiation, you need this observer to accelerate because this acceleration causes a presence of a horizon point. For example, this observer, who is time-like, will get the information from every part of the space-time throughout its full trajectory and does not need to trace over any portion. So this description will not end up in any sort of radiation, which is a genuine time-like observer. A similar thing happens for a black hole. For example, for a black hole, a time-like observer, for example, who does not end up in singularity, starts from here and moves to I plus, which is the future time-like infinity. While doing so, he will only be receiving signals from a portion of space-time, which is actually contained within this region. So in fact, he has to trace over the field description, which were given on this surface, and had the field description been in vacuum state of the matter field or field he is looking at, he has to trace over that description for that region, and he will again obtain a thermal kind of radiation, which in this context is known as the famous Hawking radiation. So as we see, and this family of observers, in order to not end up into singularity, would have to accelerate over and resist the pull of the gravity by the black hole. And hence, they will again will witness a horizon, while an infalling observer who's sitting on the surface of a star will cross the horizon, will not see any surface, and will not receive any radiation in this process. Now, I'm going to talk about a hypothetical space-time first. So let's consider the flat space-time again, which was flat throughout, but let us cut out some portion of the space-time from the top so that now the future time-like infinity is not allowed and this portion is removed from the space-time. Now there will be two time-like infinities, which are IL plus and IR plus. Just like in the case of a black hole, there are future time-like infinity or death at x plus, x is equal to plus infinity and x is equal to minus infinity. So this is depicting this. Left time-like future null infinity, right time-like future null infinity. Now again, in this space-time, suppose a I'm looking at an observer who is starting and is remaining time like throughout. He will end up, if he moves leftward, on this surface, on this point. And if he moves rightward, he will end up on this point. But now, notice here, this observer throughout his trajectory will only receive information, causal information, from the green patch of the spacetime. And will not be receiving any signal from the red patch of the spacetime. So again, this observer will have to trace over the field description defined on the right, in the right or the red patch of the spacetime. So, for example, I'm talking about in this limited context for a massless scalar field whose mode function will be time-like and null is 45 degrees line. So Cauchy surfaces are defined on scry r minus, and the future Cauchy surface will consist of this scry l plus and this surface. Similarly, for right moving observers, the past Cauchy surface I will define as scry l minus, and future Cauchy surface will be this and this surface. Okay, so as the time-like observers end on I plus, either on IL plus or IR plus, and they have to trace over a portion, and hence again their density matrix will be that of a thermal one. If I try to talk in terms of field theory on this surface, I would have to obtain the mode functions corresponding to suited on this Cauchy surface, and suppose a time-like observer, ending upon here, he would have to construct a field description suited on this Cauchy surface, this part of the Cauchy surface, just like we do for black hole case. Okay? So, as we say, Bogle-Bow coefficient are to be obtained by overlapping the mode functions suited for future null surface and past null surface. So, that was the hypothetical space-time I was considering, but let's see if that kind of space-time can be generated in any context in a so-called, in a possible or feasible scenario in any gravity theory. For this purpose, I will consider again another gravity theory, which is not Einstein gravity. It's a two-dimensional, one plus one dimension, one time dimension and one space dimension. So it's two-dimensional dilaton gravity theory in which there is a dilaton field which couples to gravity, and there is a matter field which is sitting on the space-time, which is depicted by this function f. So being two-dimensional, this metric is conformally flat. Also, there is a cosmological constant lambda sitting in this theory. So my construct of the theory is there is metric, there is a dilaton field phi, there is matter field f, and there is cosmological constant lambda. So this two-dimensional space-time, since two-dimensional space-time is inherently conformally flat, I can write down the metric like this. And there are two solutions of this space-time for any matter configuration, which is given by dx plus this equation. So if I put m is equal to 0, I will obtain essentially a flat portion of the space-time, which is called the linear dilaton vacuum. So either I can have a linear dilaton vacuum, or I can have a black hole of mass m. And that's pretty much about this space-time. This space-time is actually perturbatively unstable against forming a black hole. So whatever small amount of matter I put in this space-time, it will go straight away from being in a vacuum configuration to a black hole configuration. And these are the equations of motion which dictate this. Matter field actually splits into two parts, x plus and x minus, moving leftward and moving rightwards, and everything in the field content separates in that way. And this is the effective geometry which you obtain if there is a matter field, and p plus and m plus are some integration of the t mu nu for left moving and right moving, so on. So these are only defined for the left moving part of the matter field. So this is the Penrose diagram of this modified dilaton gravity theory, in which there is a matter field defined between coordinates xi plus and xs plus. It's a null ray, this is massless scalar field, and it's going along 45 degree lines, moving leftward, and it collapses and forms a black hole. Concentrate on this pink curve. The observer from I minus starts from being in a flat region. This region is dilaton, in this region, t mu nu support is not there, so it's a linear dilaton vacuum region. So this observer moves for a while in a flat space-time, then crosses over and feels a change of geometry because he has crossed over a collapsing shell and will be after this in a Schwarzschild kind of space-time of a black hole. So this observer, while moving, makes a jump from geometry, from being in a flat geometry to a black hole geometry, and ends up on IR plus by resisting the pull of the gravity. So this observer again will only receive radiation from the part which is below the dashed line. And this line defines a event horizon for this observer. Again, for a consistent description on this surface, you would have to construct modes suited for this surface and trace out the modes which are not reaching out to him. So this, in this, this way, first he will calculate, or he will obtain a mode functions using the equations of motion, which are in conformally flat space-time for a massless field is very trivial to construct, and will obtain mode functions like this. On scry R plus, on this surface, again he will do the same kind of setting, only by redefining the coordinates such that it runs from minus infinity to plus infinity, and use and uses again conformal flatness to obtain mode functions like this. And you just take the overlap of these two mode functions on past null infinity to obtain the Voglio-Bohr coefficient. And this is the Voglio-Bohr coefficient for these observers. And actually, if you look in at very large frequency modes, which are very close to being on this point, this essentially get reduced into the Voglio-Bohr coefficients of Rindler observer. So the concept of tracing out is very similar, and hence the, if you look only on, only on very high frequency modes, then you obtain a, the Voglio-Bohr coefficient, which are essentially Rindler, and again you obtain a radiation which is thermal with a temperature decided by lambda. And hence you obtain a, on top of that you obtain a thermal flux which is non-zero, which creates the Hawking radiation. So, so far so good. Now, let's concentrate on this dotted observer who doesn't move leftwards, rightwards, but moves leftward. Now, this observer remains for the whole part of its trajectory in the flat portion of space-time, never crosses any collapsing cell, and does not feel any pull of any gravity. So he is moving throughout in the flat space-time. So this can be an inertial observer moving at a constant velocity leftward, and will not encounter the cell ever. But still, at IL plus, he's not going to receive the full information from the surface scry R minus. So he has to trace over the region which was, he was not getting information from, on in the same philosophy which this observer used while tracing over this thing. So effectively, in this setting, all the philosophy of tracing over and semi-classical physics goes through, only with the fact the horizon here was obtained by a parameter P plus over lambda square. P plus was the integral of P plus plus, and lambda was the cosmological constant. Here, the horizon is defined by xi plus, but remember, this observer has a horizon, but no black hole as such. So, the tracing over thing goes exactly in the same fashion, and you obtain very similar Voglio-Bohr coefficient, apart from this P plus over lambda square thing gets replaced by xi plus. But you see, this P plus over lambda really doesn't play any role because it appears as a total phase. And if you calculate observable quantity like mod square, mod beta square, which depicts the flux of the radiation, it gets erased away. So both of these observers do not see any radiation whose temperature gets decided by mass. So this observer also obtains a temperature which is decided by the cosmological constant. And this observer also gets a radiation which is decided by cosmological constant. So both of them on this setting are exactly in the same, but this observer does another thing, a thing which is different from this observer. It crosses over the geometry, and that creates a flux foil. While this observer does not cross over any, does not feel any change of geometry. So this radiation, what he gets, is flux free. So in that sense, it is in a sense very analogous to Undru radiation. So it's a thermal radiation, but it's not containing any flux. So now this observers who were moving leftward, as we can again argue that they do not see any black hole as such. They do not see any gravity pull. And they do not feel, this family of observers do not see, does not see any curvature. So you can't make use of equivalence principles that acceleration is equivalent to some acceleration, that's why they are seeing a horizon. And there's no moving mirror. In fact, there is no classical source for them to associate this flux with. So all what they can associate this thermal excitation, flux-free thermal excitation, is saying that vacuum is oriented differently when you trace over that thing. So quantum correlations tracing over creates an effective thermal field for these observers, while there is no classical as such explanation which a Undru observer had, because it was moving with acceleration and was able to see a, this, able to see a horizon. While this right moving observers, they also get the same quantum correlation, but they have a vacuum polarization, that there is a flux creation due to change of the geometry, and the space-time geometry is dynamic polar. So I think my time is running over. This observer I was talking about, effectively, this is the space-time Pendulous diagram of a collapsing null shell in 3 plus 1 dimension. In 3 plus 1 dimension, we plot with T and R rather than some X and Y, Z coordinates. Suppose I am able to do that with some isotropic coordinates and unfold this diagram, it will start looking like some one of the CGHS black hole diagram I was consulting with, and left moving, right moving observer. But being isotropic, in this case, this observer also crosses over a change of geometry and sees a flux. The real observer we are talking about, which does not cross over to any geometry change and still does not get the full information, would be something like an observer who remains totally within the inside of this collapsing cell, which is like observer static at r is equal to 0. That observer will have to trace over some portion of space-time from which he will not be getting the radiation. So effectively, if the black hole completely evaporates unitarily and the black hole has this information of a state in correlation, the correlations are the same for the left moving observer and the right moving observer. So in principle, the right moving observer using the flux can create the state again, and there may be problem with no cloning theorem of unitarity, but the left moving observer has same correlation from which he could build up the same state again, but since he has not got any flux of energy or from this radiation, cannot really construct the state fully. So, okay, so let me sum over for this thing. So any tracing over leads to a thermal radiation for observers who trace over in this setting. So the past causal support of any future acronal surface decides the amount of tracing to be done. So the experience of a time-like observer will, in this case, who can be inertial, will be similar to a Rindler observer locally at high frequency limit. And the Bogle-Bow coefficients will be different from being Rindler once we move away from high frequency regime, because we are probing large portion of the space time, and then we are able to see the history that it will not be contained within a particular wedge of a space time. So it will reflect some non-thermality where the correlations could hide and contain the information of the part going inside. So that's it I would like to conclude with, and thank you for your attention.
Any quick question?
An interesting talk. Can you show us the transparency in which you...
Can you please get back to...
Oh.
Yes.
Okay. You have one situation in which there was an observer that crossed a shell that formed the black hole, and there was another observer that didn't cross a shell anywhere. Okay, sorry, it's there. Okay. The observer in the left wedge that never leave the dilaton vacuum, yes, region, will, if he carries with him a detector, detect any thermal radiation?
So in principle, yes, because its trajectory, so it depends on which kind of, suppose I'm looking at Unruh-DeWitt detector, for example.
Yeah.
Care about the correlations, and if the correlation, so for example, in flat space time, for the precise same region that the geodesics is extendable in both the directions, the total integration over the full trajectory sums out to be zero. But here it starts from minus infinity and runs to a particular point. It's not up to minus infinity to plus infinity in this proper time. So it will not sum over to infinity, and hence the detector will click.
But suppose that the detector clicks in the middle of the trajectory, okay? But then afterwards, he changes his course and now sees the whole space-time because he now gets accelerated. How is that change in his trajectory in the future compatible with the fact that his detector has already clicked?
Okay, so the point is, the way normally we talk about the Unruh-DeWitt detector, the response is determined by full trajectory integral. So in a sense, you can talk about the rate of transition at a particular point, but that is also obtained in retrospect. You have to integrate it fully up to a time t, and then get back the information, distribute over the trajectory to get an average time of response, average time of rate. So in that sense, you have to create a local detector, which does only takes correlation function in the past causal support of the detector. Those detectors will behave exactly like that those in flat space-time, which is fully extended and there is no black hole collapse. But those detector in Minkowski space-time will also clear. So the response of the both the detectors will be similar had there been a black hole or not, if the detector relied only on past causal support, but both of detectors will clear.